doesn't have to put forward a positive ideal, which would make everybody at the best much the same. You're saying that people should have the choice, really.
Yes, I'm not even so much concerned. I mean, I don't know that Freud would necessarily bring about people being much the same, except in these respects of being workable, in a certain sense of workable. I mean,
it seems to me to be a good thing that one's feelings should be directed exclusively onto their objects and not be transferred from some obscure thing which one knows very little in one's early life.
But here you're making a Freudian assumption which I reject.
Oh, you think that's not true?
Well, I mean, you're implying that where people have objectives which bring about anxiety and misery, these are in some sense false objectives behind which the true but hidden objectives lie. I would deny
that. Not always, but quite often I think that is so. And demonstrably so in individual cases.
I think it's sometimes so, yes, but I...
But if that is so, then you surely wouldn't want anybody to remain in that state, however fruitful.
I'm not sure about this. I think it's sometimes too readily assumed that a certain kind of self-knowledge is self-evidently worth having. Perhaps at the price of surrendering other things. I mean, this the philosophy of Stuart Hampshire, I think, makes a very interesting use of this idea that self-knowledge thought of very roughly in relation to the kinds of things that Freud, for instance, discovers, is not only an extension of one's freedom, which in certain respects it clearly is. I mean, if you know that you have a certain kind of neurosis, you can decide whether you're going to conquer it, for instance, or not, and you may know how to try to conquer it. Yes, not only an extension of your freedom, but also something in itself desirable. Mm. I mean, this is something which I has always worried me. Ever since, if one thinks of Socrates saying that one must know oneself, it depends what this means. I mean, this is one of the things that would worry me about having too much of a reliance on or faith in Freud, that you've got a particular image of self-knowledge offered here. And I'm not sure that there aren't many different kinds of self-knowledge, and also that there mightn't be cases where you'd approve of the man who didn't bother about this at all.
Well, I think Hampshire's talking about a person who knows that he has a certain tendency of which he disapproves. He doesn't identify with it. And he thinks that if he knows he has this tendency, then he's forewarned and forearmed against it, and maybe he can resist it.
Yes.
And to resist it would be, in the simplest possible form, to not act on it, and then perhaps even to try to suppress the feeling. But why I said try to overcome it is there's an obvious limit to one's success in this kind of thing.
Yes.
I mean, we were talking at the beginning about scope of moral freedom. I mean, it's not just free to act or free to alter one's feelings.
Yes.
But I mean, to say to somebody, well, fine, you've done the right thing, now let's have the right feelings behind it next time. I mean,
certainly one's overconfidence in one's ability to alter oneself can be just as much a cause of disaster as simply regarding oneself as unalterable and not wanting to know.
About self-knowledge, I mean, there are just two points I'd like to make. I mean, one is that there's a very big difference between the kind of self-knowledge that Hampshire's talking about, that you were alluding to, that is, knowing what one's likely to do and being perhaps forewarned against it, so that one knows the kind of temptation that's likely to come. That's very different from the kind of self-knowledge which I suppose an analysis aims at, which isn't just a description of one's character as it is, but a sort of quasi-historical inquiry designed to unravel complications which cause conflict at the time when...
The two things merge into each other, don't they, really?
Well, very different.
I mean,
I might know, as it were, all about my tendencies, and yet find them utterly obscure, and feel that many of my feelings were judged by ordinary human standards quite inappropriate to their objects. And of course it is in this situation that people often begin to undergo analysis.
But I still feel that one needn't really put self-knowledge and the kind of freedom which is connected with this sort of self-knowledge into such a central position. I mean, that there are many other, as it were, sources of enlightenment in human life. I mean, there are the sources of enlightenment which are connected with religion and art, which very often don't involve any particular theory at all, or at any rate, certainly not that kind of theory about the structure of the self, as it were. I mean, I think that...
Yeah,
I mean, this
I'm
is
not
one
saying that's the only thing, but just that it is a very important thing. But to go back, in Hampshire's theory, which of course develops out of study of psychoanalytic theory, the point of self-knowledge is that you're better informed. I mean, you just have not only information about the situation you're going to be in, but about the situation which your own character creates for you. Then, his idea is your will is detached from all this material and can take, as it were, an executive decision. But the effects of self-knowledge, insofar as analysis aims at self-knowledge, is something much more obscure and complicated. I mean, it's designed to actually shift people's feelings, focus them onto different objects.
I
it's
mean,
not in any way connected with an act of will. I mean, it isn't as if somebody goes to me and says, right, now you've told me everything, now I'll go home and decide what to do about it. I mean, it's absolutely not like that. So I think that there is a very big difference.
Yes, I would, I mean, and this is where, again, I think we disagree, and we have discussed this before. I wouldn't regard what happens in analysis as necessarily properly described as self-knowledge at all. I mean, I think it's a manipulation of the psyche, which very often would not properly be called knowing something which pre-existed, but rather bringing into being something, at any rate, slightly different.
One of your deep objection to Freudian theory is that it is based on determinism. And but you do regard the action of the analyst as somehow interfering with a mechanism which really ought to be able to be self-regulating.
I feel with a theory such as that of Stuart Hampshire, which arises partly out of a background interest in say, in Freud, that one's being offered as a value in itself, the notion of having a larger area of choice and of having a greater knowledge of a certain type of one's situation. And I don't see that this assumption need necessarily be made. I mean, I think this perhaps it might be one value among others, but not a kind of compulsory one. That is, I would think that there are many other things, such as the quality of one's attachment to one's surroundings, one's relations with one's family, one's relations to religion and art and so on, where it's very difficult to find the right words here, but where the, as it were, intensity of one's interest has a morally enriching quality.
Well, I mean, what you're really talking about is not the kind of self-knowledge that you get through psychoanalysis, but the kind of self-knowledge which you get in a rather perhaps simpler way by reflecting on your own character and what you normally do, what you're likely to do, and so on. And that's what Hampshire is talking about. I think that's what you have in mind. Hampshire's point is that that kind of self-knowledge always enlarges freedom, because it gives you, his idea is, it widens your scope for effective choice. As it were, you're less often, less likely to be taken by surprise by yourself.
Yes, well, yes, all right. I mean, at some point one draws a line, I don't know, but some point, let's say, a line can be drawn between ordinary kinds of self-knowledge, things you could discover without the assistance of an expert, as it were, and what's happening in
analysis. Well, the self-knowledge acquired, if it is acquired through analysis, is of course genetic. I mean, it's essentially connected with the history of the development of your emotions. Whereas the other kind, I mean, is just contemporary. I mean, you could imagine a person who had complete knowledge of what he was likely to do in any situation.
I don't feel in any way anxious about determinism, if one thinks here of the spectre of determinism rising up, as it must do in the background, if one wishes to take a semi-scientific view of the mind, if one wants to regard the mind as a machine out of which we either can or can't step. And Hampshire, of course, who is not a determinist, thinks that you it's a great advantage. If you realize how machine-like your mind is, you then take this into account, and you're even more free than you would have been otherwise. But somebody might say, well, if there's so much machinery, aren't you afraid that the machinery will take you in as well? This, I don't myself feel anxious about this. I mean, I'm not a determinist, and I don't really think that determinism can be framed as a philosophical theory. I mean, I think it's a sort of spectre. It's a kind of extension over a total area of something which only has sense, that I take a kind of Kantian limitation view of the possibility of framing the theory of determinism.
The whole question of the different kinds of views on privacy, I mean, it's an enormous and complicated question.